This is again going to be one of the advanced workshop sessions, and so just to be warned. All right, so the title of the talk is The Epistemology of Doubt. And I just want to sort of describe my interest in doubt. I mean, I've got interest in doubt, and I've got interest in epistemology, and so this is a kind of happy marriage here of these two interests. But I'm somebody that grew up in a very conservative home. I was a kid of ministry. My whole world was Christian in a lot of ways, so it's this kind of idea. My parents were in ministry. I was part of that. I was going to church on Sundays, of course. I was going to Christian school. Sort of like my whole entire universe was Christian. And there came a point at which I had to come to grips. I had to sort of make my faith my own. And part of that struggle, part of doing that, is really what I want to talk about today. Is the doubts that come in and how to sort of grapple with those. I think by giving a kind of epistemology of doubt, we actually sort of see what doubt is, and it better helps us to be able to address doubts. Right? That's kind of how it should go, it seems to me, that doing good philosophy should sort of, it doesn't always end in these practical sort of points, but it in a way it should, such that we can actually do a sort of pastoral thing here. Because if there's any of you that either struggle with doubt or you run into people who struggle with doubt, right? I think there's actually some points here to be made that are quite pastoral. So, I was going to mention to you, these slides, some of these will be a little dense, are on my website. So if you want to try to, if you have a way to pull them up, you're welcome, of course, to do that. So it's just my name, travisdickinson.com. You'll see a little tab that says slides. That was the best way I could do it on short order here. So if you want to pull those up and follow along, you're absolutely welcome to, or get them at some point later. So let me say what I am not talking about first. Oh, sorry, was that not up? Everybody get the website? Let me say what I'm not talking about first. I'm not talking about what I would call emotional doubt, or sometimes called psychological doubt. This would be someone who deeply struggles despite the fact that they've got the sort of rationality all worked out. So it'd be somebody like who has a kind of phobia of, say, flying, right? They might know the statistics, right? What's the statistic that, you know, you're more likely to get in an accident driving to the airport than you are for your plane to go down? I think I got that from Dumb and Dumber, but I'm not sure, so we might need to check that source there. But right, they might know all that, and yet they still can't get on the airplane. Right, they've got the intellectual side of it all well worked out, but they still, you know, struggle emotionally, it seems to me, or psychologically. And I'm not talking about that sort of thing. So you might have all the reason in the world to believe in Christianity, and yet you still might struggle in this emotional sort of way. Honestly, I'm just not really talking about that. Today, though I think what I'm going to say is not irrelevant to this. We could probably also make sense of a kind of volitional form of doubt, where it's a kind of willful doubting. We sort of refuse to assent to something, perhaps, something like that. These, I think, are the doubt sort of doesn't always get a sort of good showing in Scripture. Right, there's some statements in Scripture that sort of make doubt seem like you shouldn't do it. Well, if you shouldn't do it, then it seems to me we're talking about some sort of volitional form of doubt, and that's really not what I've got in view here today. What I'm talking about is what we'll just refer to as intellectual doubt, where, and again, this is, I would think, if I took a survey of the room here and said, how many people have had this sort of experience, almost everybody would raise their hands. And that's just where you have a kind of cherished belief. And I mean cherished in a pretty particular way, not just that you're very, very fond of it, but it's very central to your worldview in various ways. And you find yourself, let's say, one day struggling with an objection, and it's that sort of intellectual struggle. That's what I want to sort of zero in on, and for a couple of reasons. One is that that's just what I'm trained to do. So in being a philosopher, I really don't have anything to say on the emotional front. This is why I don't recommend me for a marriage conference speaker either, or marriage counseling. I just don't have a lot to say. That's not, you know, zero of my training kind of figures in to be able to know what to say on the emotional front. Right, what I'm trained to do is analyze ideas and the connections and so on in doing philosophy. So really, as being a philosopher by training, intellectual doubt is really what I have something to say about. Now, I don't want to think that, though, this is completely irrelevant to the emotional thing, because I think sometimes we don't know what we should know and thereby struggle emotionally, right? I think sometimes it can help to sort of stare at the statistics of how safe it is to get on an airplane and so on, and that can help our emotional struggle in walking onto the, onto the airplane. So I don't think it's irrelevant, but I'm not addressing the emotional side of doubt. I will recommend someone that does say a lot of stuff about emotional doubt, and that's Gary Habermas. He's got two or three books, I think. They're at least one of them is completely free on his website, just published to his website, and he's really more focused in on the emotional side of doubt. And so there's definitely resources out there, but it seems to me that this issue of doubt is sort of neglected in the literature to some degree. All right, my thesis is that intellectual doubt has value and has great value in some ways. Might be switching to, there you go. Intellectual doubt has value, right? So I'm gonna say this is not a bad thing to doubt intellectually your beliefs. And I'm gonna sort of stop always saying intellectual doubt, and I'm gonna shift to just saying doubt. Just understand me to mean intellectual doubt throughout the course of this talk from here on out. What sort of value does it have? It's not good in itself. I don't think that's a good place to sort of like reside necessarily, but it does have instrumental value in the sense that it can lead you somewhere, in somewhere good, to some other sorts of goods that are intrinsically valuable, like knowledge and truth. So doubt has instrumental value insofar as it is handled properly, and it leads you to knowledge and truth. But I think that's where it's good, and it's something not to shy away from, because coming through that process, then you presumably gain these goods when done right. And that's what we want to talk about, is in a way of how to doubt well. How to come through doubt in a good sort of way. So instrumental value, if that's not a concept familiar to you, think of exercise. That may not be a good example for all of us. It's certainly a good example for me. I don't like it. I don't think of it as, I think of it as a kind of evil, moral, right? But it is good for what it brings you. It's instrumentally good, and I've got to admit to that, and that is health or something like that. Making money is an instrumental good. It's not good in itself to sit around with stacks of cash, not even if you're Scrooge McDuck and like to go for the swim in the, anyway, I have kids. Right? Nobody wants just stacks of cash, because those aren't goods in themselves. They're goods, it's a good insofar as it gives you stuff, things to buy and so on. And doubts like that. Not good in itself, not particularly enjoyable, not a place to stay, but I want to defend the thesis that it's good because it leads to knowledge and truth and rationality. Okay? Now, I think talking to probably Christians here, I think some people doubt a bit too much, right? There's some people who really get beat up by doubt. And this might dip into the sort of emotional side of doubt, too, to some degrees. But there does seem to be people that are just constantly struggling, right? They've had an issue, intellectual sort of objection. They're thinking about it, they've had good responses to it, and yet they still just, you know, sort of wishy-washy on it, and they just let doubt beat them up continually. But I also want to assert the claim that some people do not doubt quite enough, and I think a lot of Christians don't actually doubt enough. They don't think carefully and deeply about their beliefs and their worldview, and again, I'm not guessing that's most of you because you're at an apologetics conference and you're interested in these things, presumably because you ponied up some money to come to this conference, but you know who I'm talking about. There's some people who just honestly don't ask the deep and difficult questions, not because they've got good answers to them. They just don't care, presumably, or they just don't want to. And I think it's probably pretty healthy. Their faith would be far more healthy if they would doubt a bit more, maybe a lot more. All right. Let me try to say a little bit about, this is the epistemology side of it, and I at least tried to warn you that this is an advanced workshop, so some of this will go kind of quick. If you don't get all of it, again, the slides are up on the website. So I'm happy to try to clarify any of these concepts as we get there, but we're going to pull in some epistemological concepts because I actually think there's an interesting intersection between the philosophical work on what are called defeaters and doubt, and that, again, will yield these sort of pastoral points at the end. Okay. Here's kind of a first stab at trying to say something about what doubt is, and I'm not setting it up as a definition, but just what it involves, but it's just the first stab. So doubt involves, I say here, the pull of what we take to be, is important, that we'll flesh out here in a minute, a defeater for one of our beliefs. So what's a defeater? Well, it might be easiest to say, first of all, what a state of defeat is, what it is when one of your beliefs gets defeated. And that is when the belief is no longer rational to believe, right? In some way or the other, and different ones have tried to give a kind of taxonomy of these states of defeat and so on. But I think the sort of easy sort of, you know, have a handle on it is just to understand that what defeat is when the belief is no longer rational or no longer justified to believe. And again, there's a couple ways in which that can happen, and I'm happy to bring that up in the Q&A time if you like. A defeater, then, right, that's just what it is to have a belief defeated. A defeater for some claim, proposition, let's just call that P. A defeater for P, some belief that I have, is a claim that is indirectly or directly contrary to P, right? So let me give you some example. Let me give you a story here. It's not that good of a story, so don't get too excited. Let's imagine I'm at the zoo, and I'm viewing the zebra exhibit. I think there's such things at zoos, right? A zebra exhibit. I'm looking at a bunch of animals that I take to be zebras. I see what appears to be a zebra, and on the basis of that experience, I believe that there's a zebra before me. Suppose while still looking at what I take to be a zebra, I hear a reliable source, somebody I know that's overall trustworthy, I hear from a reliable source that, given a shortage of zebras, the zookeepers have hired Hollywood makeup artists to disguise some of the mules. Right. Certainly as interesting. Mules are certainly as interesting. Watch. Mules to look just like zebras. As a result of hearing this report, I'm no longer sure I'm looking at zebras anymore and not a cleverly disguised mule. I've now got a defeater for my belief that there's a zebra before me. They follow that, right? So I now have this sort of objection that makes it such that my belief, I'm looking at a bunch of things that look like zebras, and I believe that they're zebras, but now my justification is sort of ruined, in a sense, because a cleverly disguised mule would look exactly the same. So I can't say for sure, given my evidence set here, that I'm looking at zebras anymore. It's been defeated. That make sense to you? Yeah. Defeat him? Okay. There's a lot more we can say about these, and again, we can get a lot more precise, and this is really where it gets sort of tricky to say exactly what a defeater is. But so long as you kind of have a general idea of what's going on, when you have a belief, it seems to be a well-justified belief, you pick up some more evidence, and now your belief is defeated. Okay. Now, instead, we're not going to be so much talking about defeaters as much as what I'll call a potential defeater. And a potential defeater is one in which you don't yet have good reason to believe the contrary claim. So we're not talking about the zoo example anymore. It would be more like, you know, you hear it from somebody, but you don't know that they're a reliable source. Maybe you have some reason to think they're a bit of a trickster, spinning tall tales sort of thing. Though you're not sure about that either, right? There's an objection out there. You're not sure what to do with it. It's not yet defeating your belief. We will call that a potential defeater. So it's when the subject S does not yet have good reason to believe the contrary claim, at least sufficiently good reason, I should probably say there. Right? And you can kind of, again, sort of feel the difference when you're not yet sure the claim is a legit claim about the cleverly disguised mules. And once you then pick up evidence to say, no, there really are in this exhibit cleverly disguised mules, you see that, boy, that evidence really matters. I want you to sort of see that and feel that the evidence matters there. And that's my next deal here. Evidence matters for defeaters. A potential defeater becomes an actual defeater. A potential defeater becomes an actual defeater when there are sufficiently good reasons to believe the defeating claims. That makes sense to you? So you might be considering an objection. You really don't know if the objection or the contrary claim has got good reason behind it. But it becomes an actual defeater when you do pick up sufficiently good reasons to believe that defeating claim. Okay, back to doubt. Doubt, then, is when we really feel the force of a potential defeater, right? We're kind of being seduced by it. We're kind of feeling that attraction to believe it. We're thinking, oh no, right? That might be true. And if it's true, then it defeats my belief. Another way to just say the same sort of thing, it's when we are finding a potential defeater to some degree plausible. Perhaps even more specifically, it'd be something like, when we're finding a contrary claim that is a potential defeater to some degree plausible, something like that. Okay, here's the account specified as philosophers like to do it. S doubts that P, the IFF is just if and only if. So some person, S, doubts that P, if and only if. Three things. S believes that P is true, right? It's not going to be a defeater if you don't hold the P as true. Because there's nothing to do, it wouldn't be doing defeating, it'd just be a regular old belief, right? So you have to believe that P is true. The thing you're doubting has to be something you believe is true. Two, S does not yet believe Q, otherwise it'd be, you know, you'd have contradictory beliefs, or at least contrary beliefs. S does not yet believe that Q is true, but finds Q plausible to some degree. Q is going to be the contrary claim. And three, I'm going to illustrate this in a second, so if this isn't like singing your song here, hopefully the illustrative will do a little better. S believes that Q is a potential defeater, believes that. So S doubts that P, if and only if. S believes that P is true, one. Two is S does not yet believe Q is true, otherwise you'd have contrary beliefs that you believe, but finds Q plausible to some degree. Three, S believes that Q is a potential defeater. All right, let me illustrate that, and hopefully that'll become clearer. Let's say the S we're talking about is Steve. Let's name this guy Steve. Steve believes that Scripture is without error. Steve believes that the Christian Scripture is without error. But a coworker one day points out the following passages and says, "What do you think about this, Steve?" So he points out the resurrection accounts and how there's differences, clear and sharp differences. Matthew says, Matthew 28:1 says, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. Mark 16:1 and 2 says, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, came to the tomb when the sun had risen. Luke, however, says, now there were Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and also other women with them. Fourthly, John says, Mary Magdalene, that's the quote, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb. So it only mentions Mary Magdalene. That, of course, doesn't say only Mary, but it only mentions Mary Magdalene. Steve's in a little bit of tension here. He's a little, you know, wonder. He maybe hasn't thought about this before, never noticed it before. Bart Ehrman likes to say that most Christians will just kind of read these from start to finish and not put them side by side to compare the different parallel accounts, and this causes some degree of worry for Steve, right? He's not noticed these passages are actually quite different in various respects. So Steve might have some doubt here, so let's plug it into the account and see what it looks like. Steve still believes that Scripture is without error, right? Again, he wouldn't be doubting if he's already dropped that belief. It would just be he's dropped the belief. So he still believes this. He's hanging on to it for a moment, at least. That's one of our account. Two, Steve does not yet believe these passages contradict, but he's finding that plausible, right? The coworker has spelled it out in such a way that he's kind of struggling here. He's seeing, I don't know, maybe they do. Maybe these aren't. Maybe this means that there's an error in Scripture. So he's finding that, to some degree, plausible, that potential defeater. Steve also believes that if these passages contradict, then his belief is defeated. Right? His belief being that Scripture is without error. You see how it goes? Anybody want to ask questions kind of just about the account, just to make sure we're on the right, on the same page here? Make sense to you? Any clarifying questions? Are you that tired, or is it? Yes.
Can you just, while this example is up, yeah, can you relate where the S, the Q, and the P fall in, just so from a formula standpoint?
Yeah. So the P is that Scripture is without error, right? So Steve is doubting that P. The P would be that Scripture is without error. The Q is that these passages contradict. He doesn't yet believe that, but he's finding it plausible to some degree or other. And then finally, this is Q again. Steve believes that if these passages contradict, then his belief P is defeated. All right, let's keep pushing on here. Now, having seen, I hope, hopefully this, if you think the account reveals kind of the nature of intellectual doubt, then I think there's a few things we can say about sort of what to do when one finds oneself in this place of doubt. And we can cast this in terms of Steve, if you like. So what should Steve do? Let me give you just some suggestions of how to, you know, as you encounter these sorts of objections, what to do given the nature of doubt that I've tried to defend here, or at least spell out to some degree. First of all, what I want to say, this isn't just for Christians or whatever. This account really is meant to be a perfectly general one. So this could be doubt. This could be somebody doubting their own atheism or some piece within that. This could be doubting some sort of scientific view or historical view. It doesn't really matter. But one thing that I want to say is, especially when it's this sort of entrenched belief of yours, presumably one that you've got pretty good reasons to believe, hang on. You don't need to just drop the belief, just the mere fact that there's a contrary claim that you're finding to some degree plausible. And here's what I want to say to you today. I think it's important for you to hear that I find a few objections to Christianity to some degree plausible, right? Some days more than others. Right now, so I have your, what? Yeah, there you go. What? Right? You might think, how's that possible? Well, look, I mean, The problem of evil is a difficult problem, it seems to me. How there could be a God who is all good and all loving and all powerful, and yet we've got the degree of evil that we have, the degree of pain and suffering that we have in the world. That seems to me to be a difficult problem. And again, some days harder than others. Some days, especially when I have a student or somebody in my family or somebody says, well, what about this, particularly horrible situation that I've gone through? How do you say that there's an all-good, all-powerful God in light of that? That can be very, very difficult, it seems to me. And there's some days where I can look at the problem of evil and find it quite plausible that the world in some ways looks godless given the amount of evil, pain, and suffering in the world. Or take some textual issues. I don't know what to do with every textual issue that I've come across in my time, right? It's not always so easy to say what to do with these textual issues. So, spelling it out in a certain way, sometimes I say, look, there's at least pieces of my Christian worldview that I sometimes do, I at least have questions about. There's deep and difficult questions that I don't know exactly what to do with them. But now, does that mean I'm like on the precipice of walking away from Christianity? No, not even really close to that, because I think I've got so many other reasons that if I can just sort of do it in this simplistic sort of way to say that, yeah, there's some objections that I find to some degree plausible, but I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian apologist, in fact. And so, of course, there's a whole host of reasons that I've got that really surpass and outweigh the few things that I do, from time to time think, I can see that objection. I can see why people find that, persuasive and so on. Right? Because we want to remember that a merely plausible claim is not necessarily a fully reasonable claim. And that's really important. I find things plausible all the time that turn out to be terrible ideas. And you do too. I mean, we all do, if we're honest, right? If it's a really good sales pitch, I find myself saying, yes, I do need a new vacuum cleaner, for $1,500. That's exactly what I should spend my hard-earned money on, right? Because they've made it so very plausible, but when you sort of take a step away from the intense sales pitch, you might say, no, at the end of the day, that's not fully reasonable. And I think objections often do that to me. If I haven't encountered the objection before, and I think this is probably a pretty common experience, if you haven't encountered a particular objection before, it may sound like the sales pitch that's really plausible, and then when you start to think about, but let me push on this a little bit, let me see where it comes out rationally, it may not, at the end of the day, be fully reasonable. And really fully reasonable, because something can be to some degree reasonable and still not defeat straight away your Christian worldview or whatever worldview you hold to. Now, I think this only sounds strange, in case it does sound strange, is because we're not used to, as Christians, I think, considering objections. Right? We sort of stick our fingers in our ears and say, I just don't want to even think about it because it may cause me to struggle. So if it sounds strange to you for me to say I find a few things to some degree plausible, then I think you should pause, as John Mark has said a number of times, pause, right, and ask yourself whether or not you're asking those deep and difficult questions. A distinction that I make that I think is an important one is to say I'm not 100%, especially if we mean mathematically certain that Christianity is true. I'm not 100% certain, especially in the mathematical sense of certainty, that Christianity is true, right? And I'm not afraid of losing my job, just so you know, because I think that's all of us. That's just because what mathematical certainty would be, right? I am confident that it's true. I might even be willing to say 100% confident that Christianity is true, so much so that I've given my life to it, to its truth. But I'm perfectly rational and perfectly willing to say all at the same time that I'm not 100% mathematically certain. And I happily have more of that discussion, because I know that might sound provocative to some of you. Okay, let me give you another sort of example of what I think is going on, why I think you can hang on even though you might have some doubts, you might have some objections that you don't know what to do with. I want to say it's perfectly rational to maintain belief while one considers a doubt. Let's say we're about to get on an airplane together. I'll just be honest, I really don't know how an airplane works, right? If you push me on it, I know a little bit about the shape of the wing and the phenomenon of lift and so forth. I know a little bit about it, but if you really pushed me on it, I could not tell you much about how an airplane made of metal, right? Isn't it made of metal? Aluminum, maybe? Anyway, it's heavy stuff. Let's just go with heavy stuff. It's made of heavy stuff. And yet it cruises through the sky like 5 or 6 miles off the planet. I mean, that's amazing if you think about it. It can be a 747. I looked it up, so don't. Anyway, it's about 1 million pounds of weight. For 1 million pounds to lift off the ground and cruise at 6 miles off the planet, I mean, that is extraordinary. And if I start to think about it too much, I can probably come up with a few doubts. I can probably come up with a few objections why that really should not happen. But when my flight gets called, you're in my flight gets called, I'm getting on the airplane, right? And I think I do that very rationally because I've watched Dumb and Dumber and I know that one statistic about flight. And I know some other things. I've done it before. I know a lot of you have done it. I know a lot of people that I trust have done it. And it's been very, very safe. So I know it works, even though I could definitely come up with some objections to why it should work. Did you have a...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Could another reason you get on the airplane be because of economic reasons that you already spent, like, probably $200?
Definitely, because I'm cheap, too. No, I think so, but what I'm trying to identify is that I think I can do that rationally, too. I might have these other sort of pragmatic reasons for getting on the flight, but I think I'm pretty rational in getting on the flight, even though I really sort of find myself in this place of wonder of how that could possibly happen, and I could sort of struggle with it. I can even be 6 miles up, flying, having a deep discussion with someone about how in the world is this possible. And I think that's pretty rational because I've got pretty good reasons to think that that whole endeavor is pretty safe. All right. Again, remember, it's not just a potential defeater here, right? So you shouldn't just concede when you have a potential defeater you're finding plausible straight away. Now, you might need to concede at a certain point. That's what we're going to talk about next. But it's not until it's an actual defeater that one should concede one's belief. That's the point. So hang on. Number two is I want to say that you should doubt your doubts. And a lot of people have talked about this. I don't use the phrase in the way that everybody uses the phrase. What I mean by doubt your doubts is just a sort of clever way to say it, is that you should evaluate the epistemic status of the contrary claims you're finding plausible. Epistemic status, it might be just a way to say it's how rational is this doubt? Right? How much reasons do I have to believe that the airplane at the end of the day is an unreliable mode of transportation? And I want to give you two ways to actually do this. Two ways to evaluate your doubts. First, ask, so what? Right? And the second is to ask, is the claim reasonable? Is it, in fact, more reasonable than my current beliefs? Okay. And what that does is it puts us in a place to sort of put it into its proper perspective, to say, look, am I just finding a couple things a little, to some degree plausible, and yet I've got this mountain of evidence on this other side? And again, that doesn't matter if it's scientific theory, Christianity, atheism, or whatever else. If I'm there, it seems to me that shouldn't defeat a whole mountain of evidence when I just have a belief or two that I'm not sure exactly what to do with it, right? So we need to evaluate these beliefs to say what's it got going for it? What are the contrary claims have going for them? Okay, let me say a little bit more about both of those. So we ask, so what? Here we just say, let's say it's true. What's really the problem, right? So what? If it's true and reasonable, Is it a genuine defeater? Because it may not be a genuine defeater at the end of the day. Is it truly a contrary claim? Because remember, in my account that I gave of this, the third condition said S believes that Q is a potential defeater. Just believes it. It doesn't have to actually be a potential defeater to be in this place of doubt. It just has to believe that it is. And then you're feeling the force of it. You're feeling the pull of it. But we got to ask, it seems to me, is it really a potential defeater? Do differences, or sorry, that's probably not well worded there. We need to ask what reasons it has going for it that would in fact defeat. I'm sorry, no, we're asking if it's, sorry, I'm getting confused here. In other words, go back to Steve, where he's looking at these different resurrection accounts and noticing differences of details. Do those actually entail contradictions? And I want to say they don't. Right, they're differences, but there's a big difference between mere differences of detail and contradictions. So when we look at these laid out together, what we'll notice is that none of them say, this would be a big problem if, say, John 20, verse 1 said, Mary Magdalene came alone to the tomb. Then we've got a genuine contradiction, but just because John says Mary Magdalene came, and let's say Matthew says Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came, right? Those are logically consistent accounts because we often, I think Tim was referring to some of this a bit ago, that we often are sort of selective of who we mention when there's a list of people in view. So if the president of Southwestern came by my office and he brought a few people, you know, he's got kind of a throng of assistants that, you know, kind of follow him around a little bit, and if there's any in the room, I'm sorry. Right, it would be perfectly rational or perfectly consistent in some cases to say, Dr. Patterson came to my office today, and only mention him. And then in other contexts, let's say my wife wants to know every detail of my day, as she often does, then I might mention Dr. Patterson, Joe, Bob, and Steve. Those are his assistants, right? And I give this fuller list to her. It could be the case that John's audience has no idea about the other Mary, Salome, and Joanna, and the rest, and that John is just mentioning as a kind of representative, the most prominent member, namely Mary Magdalene. And so I think what this should help for Steve is to see that these accounts are actually quite consistent, or could be, at least possibly are consistent. We can put them together logically. It doesn't entail, at least, a contradiction. All right, the second way to evaluate our doubts is to ask, is the contrary claim reasonable? This is really to look at number two from the account. Remember, that said, S finds Q plausible to some degree. But a crazy claim, as I mentioned with the vacuum cleaner salesman, can strike us as plausible, at least for a moment. But we got to ask, is it reasonable? And if it's not reasonable, then it seems to me that shouldn't defeat our beliefs, right? We've sort of put doubt in its place. If it was reasonable, it'd be a big problem, but it turns out at the end of the day to not be reasonable. Let me give you an example of that. Let's say it's around Easter time, which we're getting a little close to that now, and you start hearing about these PBS shows that are going to come out saying things about Christians and Christianity and the existence of Jesus and so on. Let's say that the claim is that there's been a new discovery of an ancient Palestine ossuary that bears the name Jesus, son of Joseph. The claim is made that they have discovered the bodily remains of Jesus Christ. Right? Is that a problem for my belief that Jesus Christ rose from the dead? You bet. But that shouldn't just straight away defeat my belief, it seems to me. If it was true, if it was reasonable, then I'm sort of in big trouble here in that belief. But we got to ask that question. We got to ask what reasons. And, you know, these things are, what I say is this tune is played before, and it's not always very convincing. It's not always a hit. right? If the ossuary dates early and it looks to be authentic, again, I got a problem. But if it turns out to be the case that it's an obvious fabrication if it's a, what's that called when it's a forgery, if it's a forgery, then problem dissolved, it seems to me. That makes sense to you, right? There's just no reason to believe it, even though if it were true, it'd be a big problem. Now, what you might be thinking, isn't this all a bit risky to be saying we should doubt our beliefs a little bit? I think no more risky than ignoring our doubts. In fact, I think that more people walk away from Christianity because they've been told by pastors, probably well-meaning pastors to some degree, that they should just pray about their doubts and try to avoid them as well as they can, right? And then I think what happens oftentimes is some crisis or other hits, right? And all of a sudden the thin answers that they've sort of grown up with, that they have, don't seem like very good answers anymore, and people walk away. And really, I mean, this might be a little scary, but no matter where one ends up, it seems to me that the person will be more rational as a result. So I think it's a good either way, even if somebody walks away from the faith. And that's, of course, the very last thing I want to have happen. But I think if one does it in this way, that they're taking an honest look at their beliefs and just finding them wanting, then they're just acting rational, and I just don't think we can criticize that, it seems to me, or say, don't do that, right? And we do that, and I think in the church that happens far, far too often. But let me give you a couple other just practical suggestions. One is to take this process very slowly. You know, so if you've not been used to really grappling with the deep and difficult questions of Christianity and worldview and these issues, take it slow, because you can get overwhelmed pretty quick. And I also say do this in community, which is largely, again, what we're doing right now. But I will say just a couple other last points, and we'll open up to Q&A. Christians really do. Again, we've sort of lost our way in this, but Christians stand in a long and rich tradition of considering the hardest objections and offering thoughtful responses. See Augustine's Confessions, see C.S. Lewis, and see a lot of other folks throughout. I mean, really, Tim's been putting before us all these figures that we don't even know their names that did this very thing. In fact, sometimes the objections that are like the classic objections were created by Christians because they were pushing hard on the faith to say, let's try to consider these hardest objections and see what the best response we can give. But how are we doing? How are you doing in this? Have you considered the deep and difficult questions of Christianity? This is a thesis, so you may not agree, but I think that Christianity has the resources to address our deepest and most difficult questions. Right? I just tell you honestly, I'm standing up here in the job I have here at Southwestern and the beliefs that I have simply because I've found the Christian responses far more plausible than any other response. Do I know what to do with every single objection that could possibly come down the pike? No way, and I would never pretend that I do. I've thought about, I think, most of them. Maybe you'll bring up one that I haven't thought of, but and I think that the Christian response is satisfying at the end of the day, especially when you sort of look at it as an overall worldview. I think there's no better story out there than the Christian story. Okay? But in order to get to these answers, we have to ask those deep and difficult questions. Now, again, here's the virtue of it all. Here's the value in doubt, is that if Christianity can address our hardest questions, and again, you might disagree with that, but if it can, then I think we come out the other side of that, this process that I'm recommending, that we'll call doubting our faith from time to time. I actually did a youth conference a few weeks ago, and one of my talks was entitled "Permission to Doubt Your Faith." My wife said, "Are you really going to go to high schoolers and say they can?" Yes, absolutely. Once we understand what we're doing, we're just asking these sort of deep Thankfully, no parents were there. But anyway, I'm just saying we should be asking these deeply difficult questions, and I just stand here as a testimony to say that there are good answers, not always knockdown, drag out answers, to the deepest, hardest questions I've come across. And I think as a result of that, we have a deeper, more abiding faith. And that would be the value of doubt. All right, so let me open it up to questions. Feel free to ask anything relevant to any of that material there. And just, I'll try to repeat it for the sake of the tape. Unless you're going to do, yeah, go here.
Hello. Hey, Dr. Dickinson. So when you were talking about just pastors telling the people in their congregation just to have faith or, yeah, you know, just to pray. Just trying to make the rubber meet the road as far as what that actually looks like in application, what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And within consideration of the text. So I just got done reading Matthew. And, you know, there's several places where Matthew is talking about, or Jesus is, I'll give you an example. Jesus, when he picks Peter up out of the water, he says, oh, you a little faith, why did you doubt? Or, for example, when he's talking about the fig tree, he says, you know, truly, truly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only be able to do with this fig tree, so far and so forth. With texts like these, mm-hmm, should we look as doubt as a good thing, you know, with what we're talking about here? Or what is Jesus saying, at least in the Gospels? If you could speak to that, that'd be great.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think of an example like Peter. Again, I don't know if you caught the point because I went through it pretty quickly, but if we're saying, hey, don't do that, you should knock that doubt off, then I don't think we're necessarily talking about what I'm talking about, because it sounds like it's saying I'm willfully doubting and I should stop doing it. Right, and so some of what you mentioned probably falls under this sort of volitional doubt, but I also think of Peter, you know, if you sort of think of Peter in the overall narrative, I mean, who had more reasons to trust Jesus than Peter did? I mean, he's in the inner circle of even the disciples, and he's confessed these massive things about Jesus, and so the oddity of Peter walking on the water and then all of a sudden looking around at his surroundings and saying, oh man, you know, this shouldn't be happening, and I really think it should. And he begins to doubt in some way or other and sinks. What I want to say there is that was the irrational position for him to take there, given all of what he knew about who Jesus was and his abilities. If he truly is the Son of God, and he's called him to do this thing, then it seems to me that was perfectly rational for him to, and it was irrational for him to doubt in that case.
So,
just go. Keep going. Yep.
I have a pretty loud voice, so I can just speak up. So, if the answer to my question may be that, yeah, it's kind of Captain Obvious, and it's kind of like a duh. But in your position of what to do about doubt, when mm-hmm. facing doubt, in asking, is it reasonable, the potential defeater, would it be something or safe to consider that the effectiveness of the potential defeater may be proportionally related to the reason that the person has for their belief? And so if, for example, a Christian who has a belief but is not well-grounded in why they believe a particular thing mm-hmm. has a potential defeater, and they ask, is it reasonable? Is that something that, you know, just trying to wrap my head around, you know, how to, you know, counsel or tell someone, hey, before you just step out and ask, is this reasonable, and take it at face value, make sure that you're well-grounded in your faith. Is that...
Yeah, I think that's right. Yeah, that's good. So if someone has a real, let's say the only reason they have for believing Christianity is true is because their parents said so or something like that, where we're just trying to imagine a case in which someone doesn't have good reasons to believe Christianity is true. And then somebody comes along and points out this sort of really, you know, maybe the problem of evil or some objection to Jesus' resurrection and so forth. That truly, they may come out the other side of that saying, I got more reasons over here. But that's, I guess what I'm, my overall recommendation is that even when we analyze and we sort of doubt our doubts, I've already said we should be doubting in some way or other. We should be asking these deep and difficult questions and in some ways seeing where does rationality end up? Where do we end up given the reasons we have there? Now, so really, again, it shouldn't be that you just look to the Christian side and see how many reasons I have to believe Christianity, because there's this question on the table now, this objection, this contrary claim. But also one shouldn't do, I think what you're imagining or asking, one shouldn't just look at how powerful is this objection if they're Christian view. In other words, one should just have a deep investigation of these issues and see where one ends up. And again, my own testimony is just to say, as I did this, it was a bit lopsided for me. It was the Christian response was very satisfying, so much so that it surpassed the sort of effectiveness of the potential defeater.
Oh, hi. I have a question, about non-believers' doubt. I just want to see how you can answer the question. For example, there are lots of people in China or India or Japan, and they're taught about social Darwinism and that they should not see each other as friends but as competitors working against each other. And they're often faced with situations where supply is less than demand, and they just think they just have to become as competitive as animals and to fight against each other in order to get something, just like the game theory developed by John Nash Jr., A Beautiful Mind. I think people believe, sometimes they believe they're in a zero-sum game where they just have to, their loss had to result from someone else's loss. And which is totally contradictory to our belief that we should love our neighbors as ourselves. I mean, if someone has this kind of question, how do you answer them? When they do not believe that God can provide everything for them, when you know God can have miracles to provide food, how do you answer them?
I might maybe just rephrase the question just once again, just so I make sure I address it directly.
Okay, when people believe they have to fight against each other in order to get something, and they don't believe. In some countries there are limited materials, limited resources. When people need more, when the supply is less than demand, and they think they have to fight against each other in order to get something.
Is your question that?
How do you answer them? I mean, if they say that's the reason that they don't believe in God because we teach we should love love others as ourselves, they think Christianity doesn't make sense. How do you answer the question?
Well, again, I guess with a thorough investigation of Christianity's reasons, I might be able to directly answer that, but it might be sufficient to just say, look, so if this is a belief that makes it such that the Christian gospel doesn't fit that sort of worldview or approach to life, Yeah, it's a problem. I mean, it's intellectually, that's a problem. If those two, if there's two beliefs that can't sort of like cohere together, then one has to go. And that's where I say, I guess I would find, maybe that's going to come out a little too strong. I was going to say, I would not find very plausible that necessarily humans should compete against one another. And that's like, yeah, I wouldn't find that plausible in the slightest, to be honest with you, because I think morally that just seems wrong. Morally, it seems wrong for me to, you know, walk straight over someone and step on their face in order to get food that they would have otherwise gotten. That seems wrong. So if that's the sort of view, and I'm not saying it's that extreme, you know, if that's the sort of logical absurdity or moral absurdity that comes from that sort of view, I think that view's got a lot of problems for it. But the overall response is just to say, look, yeah, that's the kind of intellectual tension that I think happens when we doubt. We've got something that's there that's bugging us intellectually. We're feeling the sort of pull from this contrary claim. And we've got to work that out. How do you work that out? Well, if we're talking about intellectual, the sort of intellectual realm, then we work that out with evaluating the reasons for it.
So in relation to when you're trying to solve, like when you've identified that there is a valid question to your belief,
yeah.
How do you know whether you're proceeding too fast to get to your solution, whether you're skipping over something that you should pay attention to?
I think that's where community is huge. I think where you've got some folks, and I don't just mean like-minded folks, by the way. What I love is this, and I love that, I mean, this is mostly like-minded, if we're honest here, but I love community. There's a lot of differences of opinions in the room, probably, if we pushed on a lot of things. And I think having somebody that's gone further than you and maybe been there and come through that, no matter which way, maybe even talking to folks that have come out different sides on that issue, helps you to know if you've done a thorough investigation. Because I think that is a really important, because it can sometimes feel like, hey, I've really just thoroughly investigated that. And then you meet somebody like Tim who's really, really investigated, you know, certain things. And it's like, okay, I'm just beginning here. So I think community's huge for making sure you're sort of looking at these and understanding them right and moving on. And again, I'd encourage you to talk to people that come out differently. Probably has to be the last one here, I think, to keep to our time.
So you mentioned to think about if is our doubt reasonable? But what do you mean reasonable here? Because in the Bible, there is a lot of, seems like beyond the reasonable things, like the child was born by a virgin, and people can resurrect it again.
Yeah.
So if we think these things, the doubt can, it's beyond the reasonable.
Yeah, yeah.
Things, so how do you deal with that?
So again, I stand up here because I've actually come to find that very reasonable. And I know that might strike somebody as crazy talk, but Dr. Reynolds talked about this last night to some degree in the discussion of just saying, well, look, if you just zero in on that one belief, does it strike me as a little on the crazy side? Yes. I'll be quite honest with you. Yes, it does. But when you put that in the overall, what he called a web of belief, when you put that in the overall, what I might call a worldview, in other words, I find it very plausible that God exists. And then I want to say, okay, then what, and it's God of a certain sort, a God who's morally good, I find this very plausible that that sort of God exists. But I also look out in the world, and I look at my own heart, and I see deep brokenness. And I think there's got to be, it can't be that there's a good God an all good God, and the brokenness I feel and I see in the world. But here's one way to reconcile those two disparate sorts of things, things that look like their intention, is what if God created us for redemption in order to redeem people to himself? What if that was plan A, right? Not that we sort of messed the world up in some way or other, and now God has to come back and, you know, plan B, and we're probably on like plan triple Z or something at this point. It's not that picture. It's that this is plan A, redemption. And so then I look at what all that Christian story entails, and that's one of those things. So is it in isolation hard to believe? You bet, but I think when you have reason for the overall worldview, then some of those things that are hard to understand or maybe strike us as extraordinary, because you bet it's extraordinary, I think I come to that in a reasonable sort of way. And I think we can all come to that in a reasonable sort of way. All right. Well, thanks so much. I think we're out of time here, so...